नमस्ते, माय नेम इज ज्योति दहिया एंड वेलकम टू लर्निंग विद जेडी। So now that we've seen the first four processes of project integration management in the previous video, today we are going to talk about the next three, which are a part of monitoring and controlling and closure. So that's the scope of work for us today. All right, so as we know that we are working on the sixth edition of PMBOK right now, and we are on the project integration management part two. So what are we going to cover in today's video? Today we are going to see that how do we manage and control the project work. So we've seen the initiating part, we've seen the planning, we've seen the executing in the last video. You can go back and check on my channel. And today we are going to check about how we are going to manage and control the project. What is the functionality of Perform Integrated Change Control, which we often call as PICC? It's an important aspect from a project related. So we are going to see what is the functionality of it, and we are also going to see what is the process of closing a project or a phase. All right, so these four processes we've covered in the last session: initiating, planning and executing. What have we done till now? We've developed a project charter, we've developed the project management plan, we've started the work under direct and managed project work, and we have created some new knowledges. We have used some previous knowledges under the process manage project knowledge. And in today's session, we are going to cover monitor and control project work, perform integrated change control, and close project or phase. So let's start with monitor and control. All right, so what do you mean by the word monitor and what do you mean by the word control? Monitor is observing, controlling is taking action. So monitor and control project work is the process of tracking. You first need to track, right, what is happening on your project, reviewing and reporting the overall progress to meet the performance objective defined in the project management plan. Very simple, whatever is written in the project management plan is something that needs to be delivered. Now, whether it is delivered or no is what you need to do under monitoring and controlling. This process is performed throughout the project. It doesn't happen that, you know, you will do it only at the end of the project. You will do this project, you will do this process throughout the project. So let's see what are the inputs and outputs and what are the tools and techniques that we are going to use. So we've n number of times discussed on what are the inputs and outputs. Input and output are nothing but documents. Yeah. So the first document that you need to monitor and control your project is what? Of course, the project management plan. Everything as to how is mentioned in the project management plan. How the project will be executed, how you need to monitor it, and how you need to control it. All these part is a part of project management plan. So monitoring and controlling project work involves looking at all the aspects of the project. Any component of the project management plan may be an input of this process. Any of the document which is a part of project management plan. So what all are the documents which are included in the project management plan? All the subsidiary management plan, all the baselines and some other components including the change configuration management and all that stuff. Change management system, configuration management system and etc. Then you also need your project document. Lot of components of the project document including the assumption logs, the basis of estimate, the milestone list, the quality reports, the schedule forecast. All these are a part of the project document. Now you need all these documents, you refer all these documents to work on monitoring and controlling your project work. Then you need the work performance information. Now what is the work performance information? There is some work performance data that is collected through the work execution section and it is passed on to the controlling processes. So when the data is extracted from the execution and passed on to the monitoring and controlling process group, it is known as work performance information. You need to know, right, what is the work that is performed, and you need to monitor on that. To become work performance information, the work performance data are compared with the project management plan components. So there are three components that you will keep on hearing: work performance information, work performance data, and work performance report. So work performance data is a raw observation that you get from an execution section. We saw in the previous session, which comes from the direct and manage project work. Then there is work performance information. This is nothing but a comparison between the observation and the project management plan. This comparison indicates how the project is performing. Then you also need agreement. There will be some third party involvements. You want to know that how are the work which is aligned with the third party is working. So a procurement agreement includes the terms and condition and may incorporate other items that the buyer specifies regarding what the seller is to perform or provide. So all these are a part of the agreement, and hence you need the agreement. Then you also need EEFs, because even at the time of monitoring, you would want to know that what are the factors that are impacting your project. EEFs originate from the environment outside of the project and often outside of the enterprise. These factors refer to conditions which are not under the control of the project team that influence, constrain, or direct the project. Yeah. Then you also need your OOPAs, all the formats, all the procedures, all the planning, all the processes. Everything is a part of your organizational process assets, and these are internal to your enterprise, and hence you will need all these at the time of monitoring and controlling your project work as well. So these are the input documents. So these are all the documents that you've kept ready for monitoring and controlling your project work. Now let's see what are the tools and techniques that can be used. Now the first one is expert. We know experts get job everywhere. So expert judgment. Expert can be a individual, it can even be a group from a specialized knowledge or training. So you may also do some data analysis techniques. Some of the data analysis techniques that can be a part of monitor and control project work are alternative analysis. What do you mean by alternative analysis? Alternative analysis is used to select the corrective action or a combination of corrective and preventive actions to implement when a deviation occurs. In case if a deviation has occurred in your project in terms of your scope, your cost, your schedule, anything, an alternative analysis as a technique can help you create a scenario where a corrective action can be taken or a combination of corrective or preventive action can be taken. The cost-benefit analysis. The cost-benefit analysis helps to determine the best corrective action in terms of cost. The focus here is main on the cost in case of the project deviation. In case if there is any deviation in your cost, this is going to be the cost-benefit analysis is going to be the best one to determine the corrective action. Then comes the earned value analysis. So we are going to talk about earned value in quite detail when we are going to do cost and time, because there are a lot of formulas there which is going to be very important for you from your examination perspective. You have to keep all that in mind. So earned value provides an integrated perspective. It provides a combination of perspective in terms of your schedule, scope, and cost. So earned value analysis defines that only by understanding that the schedule is behind or the cost is over, you cannot determine that the project is on path or no. All the key three factors, which is scope, schedule, and cost. When you take all these three factors into consideration, only then you will understand what is the status of your project, and hence earned value analysis. Then root cause analysis. Root cause analysis focuses on identifying the main reason of the problem. Root cause analysis is a technology which is used for identifying what is the real problem of the for the deviation in the project. Trend analysis. Trend analysis is used to forecast. It typically helps you tell that till now, if the trend has been such, what will be the trend be in future? So that is what is known as trend analysis. Variance analysis. Variance analysis reviews the differences as to what is the difference between what was planned and what is actual, and what is going to be the future realistic output for it. It can be a possibility that something has been planned for, that some work will be completed in a week's time, but from last 6 months, that work does not get completed in 1 week. It takes around 10 days. So that is what is known as variance analysis, to identify what is the difference between the planned and actual performance. Then comes decision making techniques. What do you mean by decision making? It is about taking a decision whether this needs to be continued or no, or some change is required or no. All this happens at the time of monitoring and controlling. Understand, the project has initiated, planning is completed, execution is going on, and at the time of execution, you are trying to monitor and control your project. There are n number of decision making techniques. One of them is voting. Voting can also include making decision based of unambiguous and majority or plurality. So it all depends upon what the output of the voting would be. Meetings. Meetings may be face-to-face, virtual, formal or informal. They may include project team members. Some stakeholders may also come, right? So these are all the techniques which are used for monitoring and controlling your project work. Now, once you monitor and control your project work, you know that there is a deviation. You try to find out what is the earned value. You try to find out what is the trend. The output is the third element that I was talking about, is the work performance report. Now, work performance information is combined, recorded, and distributed in a physical or an electronic format. Now, this data is often recorded, combined and recorded for future purpose. This is also creates awareness. It helps in generating decisions or actions. They are circulated to all the project stakeholders. Very important, because the stakeholders should know where is the project going on and what is the status on the project. They can be presented as dashboards, heat reports, stoplight charts. So these are n number of reports which are available. Any representation data is known as work performance report. You may get a question around work performance information, work performance data, and work performance report. You need to make it very clear that you understand what the concepts are. Work performance data is the raw output data that you get from direct and managed project execution. Work performance information is the comparison of that raw data with what actually was planned. And work performance report is an output of monitor and control project work that determines if any change is required, and it is presented in the format of a heat report or a stoplight chart or a dashboard to all the stakeholders. Yeah. Then there can be change requests coming up here. Now, this is for the first time that a change request is coming. Now, till now, you are executing the project. When you are monitoring and controlling, you either need to take a corrective action or a preventive action, or you need to change in the scope of the project. Now, that is what is known as change request. As a result of planning, comparing planned result to actual result, change request may be issued to expand, adjust, or reduce the project scope or quality. And quality requirements can schedule or cost baseline. So it all depends upon whatever the change request has come. Now, will this change request directly go to direct and manage project work and the work will be executed? No. These change requests will go to perform integrated change control, PICC. Only after that the work will begin. Changes may include corrective action, preventive action, or defect repair. A corrective action, an intentional activity that realigns the performance of the project work with the project management plan. Understand, it is intentional activity, it is done purposely. Preventive action, an intentional activity that ensures the future performance of the project work is aligned with the project management plan, that whatever will happen in the future will be aligned with the project management plan. And defect repair, that you agree that there was a problem in the project management plan and you want to repair it. So an alignment act an intentional activity that modifies a non-confronting product or product component. So that is what is known as defect repair. Then let's see what are the outputs of monitor and control project work. The project management plan may get updated. There are certain documents that will impact the project management plan. Changes identified during the monitor and control project work process may affect the overall project management plan. Project document updates can happen. The cost may change, cost forecast may change. Issue log may get updated, the lessons learned will be registered. So there are n number of the risk register, schedule forecast. These are all the documents that may get updated. Yeah, so that's about the monitor and control project work. Now let's see what do you understand by the word perform integrated change control. Now perform integrated change control is the process of reviewing all the change requests. See, the name itself has change control, which means it controls whatever changes are, appearing on your project, approving changes and managing changes to deliverables, project document and the project management plan and communicating the decisions. If a change request is not approved, it will be declined. No impact will happen again on the project management plan or, any of the project document. But in case if the change is approved, it will be updated accordingly, and that change has to be a part of your deliverables now. That is the role of perform integrated change control. Then perform integrated change control inputs the project management plan. Some of the plans that you need for managing the change in as a part of the perform integrated change control is your change management plan, the configuration management plan, the change management plan, the configuration management plan, the scope baseline, schedule baseline, cost baseline, all of these will be impacted. Then you also need your project document. Why? Because you need to know what is the basis of estimate, the requirement traceability matrix, and the risk register. Then work performance report. Now, where do you get the work performance report from? You remember? It was an output from the previous process, which is monitor and control project work. So work performance report of particular interest to the performance integrated change control process includes resource availability, schedule and cost data, earn value reports and burn up or burn down charts. These are all the ways of presenting the work performance report. It is nothing but giving a brief about where the project is progressing, what is the status on the project, and how do we manage the changes that are coming up. And some of the documents that you also need is your change request. You remember, change request is also an output from the monitor and control project work. Change request may include corrective action, preventive action, defect repair. Now, these are all the changes that may come up during the course of your project. Yeah, you also need your EEFs. EEFs originate from outside the project and outside the enterprise. The project team does not have a control over that. And you also need your OPAs. All right, so now let's see what are the tools and techniques. Expert judgment. Expert comes everywhere. You will see expert in most of the processes, and specifically in the integration, experts are available because integration is the most important knowledge area where everything comes together and gets combined, right? So expertise can be individuals or groups of the specialized knowledge or training. Change control tools. Now there are some of the tools that the team of change control board uses in order to facilitate configuration and change management. Manual or automated tools may be used. It can depend whether you want to use a sophisticated automated tool or you want to use a manual tool. Tool selection should be based on the need of the project stakeholder, including the organization and environment consideration and or the constraints. It all depends upon which environment you are, which organization you work for, what is the enterprise that you work for, and what are the factors that are impacting your organization. All the change control tools, whether it is manual or automated, depends upon that. Again, the data analysis. We use data analysis during monitoring and controlling your project work as well. Similarly, you will use it during your perform integrated change control process also. So alternate analysis, we already spoken about this previously. This technique is used to access the requested changes and decide which are accepted, rejected, or need to be modified to be finally accepted. Again, about the cost-benefit analysis, this comes when the matter is associated with the cost. This analysis helps to determine if the requested change is worth its associated cost. The change is worth of whatever you are going to invest in terms of the money, in terms of cost. Then comes your decision-making. Decision-making technique that can be used for this purpose includes voting. Voting is again decision-making, autocratic decision-making, and multi-criteria decision-making. Then another tools and techniques which is often used for perform integrated change control is meetings. You meet the stakeholders, you meet other team members, you meet the sponsor to decide whether a change is requested. The change that is requested needs to be approved or rejected or deferred. Approved change request. Now this is an output from perform integrated change control. Change requests are processed according to the change management plan. Remember that we prepared a change management plan during the planning process. Now whatever it has been approved, whatever it has been mentioned in the change management plan, the changes will be approved accordingly. So change requests are processed according to the change management plan by the project manager, the change control board, or an assigned team member. Whoever is being assigned for this specific work will be executing the changes that have been approved. Project management plan now gets updated. Any formally controlled component of the project management plan may be changed as a result of this process. Changes to the baseline are only made from the last baseline forward. Whatever was updated in the last baseline, from that onwards, the changes will now be updated. Past performance is not changed. Remember, this is very critical. Underline this, that your past performance will not change. Whatever changes at the baseline will happen from now onwards, from whatever it has been updated now. Whatever change, whatever has happened earlier has happened. And the project documents get updated. Any formally controlled project document may be changed as a result of this process. A project document that is normally updated is the change log. The change log is used to document changes that occur during a project. Got that? So these are the two key processes of the monitoring and controlling process group. Now we are going to see at the last process of the closing process group is close project or phase. The close project or phase is the process of finalizing all the activities for the project. Now at this point of time, your entire planning, your initiating is done, your planning is done, you started the project, the monitoring and controlling is done, you monitored the project, you controlled the project out. As a result of the controlling, some change requests were come, you executed those change requests, again deliverables were out, were an output of that, and then your project has been completed and it is the finalization of all the activities. Remember, all the activities have to be closed before starting this process. It cannot happen that some of the process is open, for example, procurement or any agreement is open and all that stuff, and you still go ahead and close the project. No, that is not possible. So close project or phase is the process of finalizing all the activities for the project, phase or contract. The key benefit of this process are the project or phase information is archived, the planned work is completed, and the organizational team resources are released to pursue new endeavors. The team has been released, they will move out, they will go and manage some other team project now. At this point of time, this is the closure of the project. Now, let's see what are the inputs that we need. Of course, we need the project charter. Now, this is the first document that was created. You see how we joined the dots? The first document that was created at the time of initiation, and this is the last document that we are creating at the time of closing the project or the phase. So you need that project charter because the project charter documents the success criteria, the approvals that are required. At that point of time, we had mentioned what are the approvals that we need and who is going to sign off the project. So all that information is a part of the project charter. And we also need the project management plan, because all the components of the project management plan is an input in this process. It is very important for us to view that all the components are closed. You also need your project document, because all the documents which are a part of the project document may be an input to this process. Accepted deliverables, very important, please understand. Accepted deliverables may include approved product specification, delivery receipts, and work performance documents. All the documents that are ready and the accepted deliverables that are ready will now be handed over to the person who's going to sign off the project. It will be given to them and the entire project will be closed only after that. Partial or interim deliverables may also be included or phased or cancelled project. In case if a phase is closing, moving from one phase to another, partial or interim deliverables will be available. In case a project gets cancelled, still a project manager has to follow the process of close process or phase. Then you need the business document. You remember business document was also an input in the develop project charter. Now it is an input in close project or phase. Business document includes two key documents, with a business case and the business management plan. You will also need the agreements. All third party, as I also said, that all the third party relationship has to be closed before the closure of the project or phase. So the requirement for formal procurement closure are usually defined in the terms and conditions of the contract and are included in the procurement management plan. So all these which are mentioned here, you need to see if all these have been closed and the payout has been done or no. Procurement document, any contract that needs to be closed, all the procurement documentation is collected, indexed and filed. Information on the contract schedule, scope, quality, the cost performance, everything has to be documented properly. You need the organization process assets. OPAs are internal to your enterprise. It gives you all the processes, plans, policies, procedures, and knowledge bases. All these information you need for closing, because there are certain specific formats which are available for the closure of the project. So you need to use them. Then you will, now let's see what are the tools and techniques that you will use. Of course, you will call the expert. Expert will come and help you out in closing the project. They're going to even help you out in terms of compiling the all the lessons learned, etc. Yeah. Data analysis techniques, you will do document analysis. See, now at the time of closure of the project, you need to understand that documentation is properly done and filed. So accessing available documentation will allow identifying lessons learned, knowledge and knowledge sharing for future projects. So you're going to do that. Then regression analysis. This technique analyzes the interrelationships between different project variables that contribute to the project outcome to improve the performance on the future projects. Trend analysis. Trend analysis can be used to validate the models used in the organization and to implement adjustments for future projects. You may even do variance analysis. Variance analysis can be used to improve the matrix of the organization by comparing what was initially planned and the end result. Got that? Then you may also use meetings as a tool and technique for closing your project or phase. Meetings are used to ensure that the deliverables are accepted, that whatever the exit criteria was validated, has been validated and has been met, to formalize the completion of the contracts, to evaluate the satisfaction of the stakeholders, to gather lessons learned, to transfer the knowledge and to celebrate the success. Now let's see what the outputs are. The project document gets updated. Yes, all the project documents may be updated. Whatever has been, you've entered the lessons learned, so it is a part of the project document update. At this point of time, will you ever have your project management plan update? No, because the closure of the project is done. There's no other management that you need to now do. But the project document gets updated because the lessons learned is a part of project document. And the final product, service, or the result is transited from the project to the operational team. A product, service, or result once delivered by the project may be handed over to a different group or organization that will operate, maintain, and support it throughout its life cycle. Now, that is the entire product that you were creating, your product or service or result that you are creating. You've created as a part of your project. You will never keep it with you. You will hand it over to the organization that, you know, or to a different group for its further maintenance and support for the entire life cycle. And the final report. The final report provides a summary of the project performance, the summary level description of the project or the phase, scope, objectives, and the evidence that the completion criteria were met, which is all the signatures, all the stampages, and acceptance criteria. The quality objectives are met. The cost objectives includes the acceptable cost range, actual cost, and the reasons of any variance. Summary of validation, summary of how the final product, service, or result achieved the business needs identified in the business plan. Summary of any risk or issues encountered on the project and how they were addressed. All these are a part of the final report. Then comes your OPA updates. Organization process assets that are updated are the project document, operation and support documents, project or phase closure document, lessons learned repository. All right, so let's see what we've done today. Monitoring and controlling project work, what is it? It is the process of tracking, reviewing, and reporting the overall progress. PICC, that is Perform Integrated Change Control, is the process of reviewing all change requests. And close project or phase is the process of finalizing all the activities for the project, phase, or a contract. Got that? So guys, I hope you are clear with the first knowledge area, that is project integration management. This is the most important from your examination perspective. Understand, this is the job of the project manager to manage the integration, and hence from your examination perspective also, you will see n number of questions which will arise from this section. Both the parts, part 1 and part 2, are uploaded on my channel now. You can go back and see the part 1 as well. So that is it from my end for today's session. Guys, wait for the next session, which is coming up, where we are going to talk about project stakeholder management. Why are we taking section 13? Because it is much more relevant and much more easier for you to understand and grasp your for your examination perspective. So meanwhile, I hope you like the video. So like, share, and comment on the video. Also subscribe if you've not done that yet, and ask your friends also to subscribe. It's going to be really interesting. The more and more videos will be coming up. So till then, keep studying, keep connecting, and all the best.